Hey guys, welcome to 4pi Academy classes. So today we will discuss some short tricks and formulas of classical mechanics which will be very helpful for you to solve the CSIR NET, GATE and many other competitive exams of physics. Okay, so let's start. So if you are new to our channel, please subscribe the channel, and if you like the video, press the like button and also press the bell icon so that you can get the notification for the latest videos. And you can also visit us on our website www.4piacademy.com, and we have also a Facebook page, CSIR NET Physics Preparation. You can also follow us there. Okay, so very first topic or formula we choose is from the frequency of small oscillators. Okay, so if we have a particle and or a system, and the system is in its stable equilibrium position, means the system or particle is situated here, and if we displace the particle or the system from this position, it executes very small oscillation. Okay, and these oscillations are known as small oscillations, and we have to calculate the frequency of these small oscillations. Okay, so if you are confused about the unstable equilibrium and stable equilibrium, we have also a video of a small oscillation in our channel. You can also watch the video. I'll give the link in the description, so you can go and watch this video. Okay, so at the position of stable equilibrium and also at the unstable equilibrium point, the slope of the potential energy curve means the force at this position is zero. Okay, so du over dx equals to zero at these two points, stable equilibrium and unstable equilibrium. Okay, so if in this case, if x naught is the small displacement and the particle oscillates about this mean position, and in this case we can expand the potential energy using Taylor's formula. Okay, and if you know the Taylor's expansion, the potential energy will be ux naught plus du over dx at x equals to x0, x minus x0, plus 1 upon factorial 2 du over dx square, x minus x0 ka whole square, plus and so on. Okay, so as a value of du over dx is 0, put the value of du over dx is equal to 0 here. Okay, and the value of x minus x0 is very small because x0 is very small. So we can neglect all the higher order terms. Okay, so the remaining potential energy will be ux equals to ux0 plus 1 upon 2 du over dx square, x minus x0 ka whole square. Okay. Okay, so the formula for angular frequency of a small oscillation would be omega naught equals to under root du over dx square upon m at x equals to x naught. Okay, so simply you can use this formula if the value of potential energy is given to you and the value of the displacement is also given. So now we will see an example. This is the question based on the angular frequency of a small oscillation, and it came in NET June 2012 exam. Okay, consider the motion of classical particle in 1D double well potential, and the potential energy is 1 by 4 x square minus 2 ka whole square, and if the particle is displaced infinitesimally from its minimum position on the positive x-axis, then okay, so we have to find the correct option. Okay, so now we will solve this problem using the concept of small oscillation. Okay, so as potential energy is given, and the potential energy is 1 by 4 x square minus 2 ka whole square, and the particle is displaced from its position of minimum position of stable equilibrium. So we will calculate the value of del V over del X, and the value will be X square minus 2. Okay, you can solve this equation. Okay, so since the particle is displaced infinitesimally from its minimum position, we will put the differentiation of potential energy equals to 0. Okay, so we will put del V over del X equals to 0, and on solving this equation you can get X equals to 0 and plus minus under root 2. Okay, so two values we will get here, and further we will calculate du over dx square, double differentiation of the potential energy. Okay, so it will be 3x square minus 2, and at x equals to 0, the value will be minus 2. Okay, so the value is less than 0. So if du over dx square is less than 0, it means the potential energy is maximum, and this condition is the condition of unstable position. Okay, so at this point, the particle will be at unstable point. Okay, so if we calculate the value of du over dx square at x equals to plus minus under root 2, the value is 4. It's a positive value and greater than 0. So if du over dx square is greater than 0, means the potential energy is minimum here, and this is a stable point. Okay, x equals to plus minus under root 2 are the stable points. Okay, so we will calculate the angular frequency omega naught at the stable position. Okay, so at the stable point, angular frequency omega naught will be under root du over dx square upon m at x equals to plus minus under root 2, and the answer will be 2. Okay, so angular frequency is 2 here. We put the value of m equals to 1 here. Okay, so the particle will execute simple harmonic motion in right well with frequency 2. Okay, so the option B is correct. Okay guys, so the second topic I choose is relativity of simultaneity. Okay, and this is very very important topic and little confusing too, so please listen carefully. So according to relativity, the two simultaneous events are not absolute. Okay, the simultaneous events are the events which may be located at different points, but they are happening at the same time. Okay, like these A and B are two events here, and the events are situated at position x1 and x2, but if there is an observer P which is situated in the same frame of the events A and B, for this observer the events are happening at the same time. Okay, so for this person P, the events A and B are simultaneous events. But if there is a plane which is moving with velocity v with respect to this inertial frame, and there is a person Q which is situated in this plane, now for this person Q, the events A and B are not simultaneous. Okay, so the events are simultaneous for the person which is situated in the same frame. Okay, so this is a relativity of simultaneity, and now we will find the time difference between these two events A and B for this person Q. Okay, so the formula is delta t equals to v upon c square x2 minus x1 upon under root 1 minus v square over c square. So delta t is a time difference observed by the person Q between these two events A and B. Okay, and v is the velocity of this person Q, and x2 is the position of event B, while x1 is the position of person A. Okay, so this is very very important formula, and you can solve many problems based on this formula. Okay, okay, so this problem is related to the relativity of simultaneity, and this question is from June 2012 exam of CSIR NET. So the question is, if the two events separated by a distance 9 into 10 to the power 9 meter are simultaneous in one inertial frame, and the time interval between these two events in a frame which is moving with a constant speed of 0.8 c. Okay, so we have to calculate the time difference delta t for these two events. Okay, so four options are here. Okay, so the distance between the two events in inertial frame, that is x2 minus x1, is 9 into 10 to the power 9 meter, and the speed of the moving frame v equals to 0.8 c. Okay, so we will use the formula of time difference between the events in moving frame, which is delta t equals to v upon c square x2 minus x1 upon under root 1 minus v square upon c square. Okay, so put the value of v x2 minus x1 here and just calculate, and you will find the answer, and the answer is 40 seconds. Okay, so option 2 is correct. Okay, guys, so the third topic, which is also a common topic for CSIR NET, GATE, JEST, TIFR, and any other competitive exams of physics, this is collision of particles in one dimensional. So, if we have two particles, M1 and M2, and the velocities of these two particles are U1 and U2, okay, in this case, U2 equals to 0, only first particle is moving here, and after collision in left frame, the velocities of the particles changed, okay? So for first particle, the velocity is V1, and for second particle, after collision, the velocity is V2, okay? So this is the left frame, and if the particles are scattered after collision at some angle, okay, so theta 1 is the scattering angle for particle 1 and theta 2 is the angle of scattering for particle 2. Okay, so this is a scenario after collision. So for calculating the velocities or scattering angle, we can use few conservation laws like momentum conservation we can use. And for this case, the momentum conservation will be the total momentum before collision equals to the total momentum after collision, okay? So the linear momentum is m1 u1 for this particle, m2 u2 for second particle. So before collision, the momentum will be m1 u1 plus m2 u2, and that is equal to the total momentum after collision, that is m1 v1 plus m2 v2, okay? So we can also use the conservation law of energy, that is basically kinetic energy. The total kinetic energy before collision is equal to total kinetic energy after collision, and that will be half m1 u1 square plus half m2 u2 square equals to half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square, okay? So these are very general laws, and by using these laws we can find out many things for this system, like velocities and angle of scattering for the two particles, okay? Okay, so this is the problem in December 2019 exam of CSIR NET, and this is based on elastic collision of two identical balls. So after a perfectly elastic collision of two identical balls, one of which was initially at rest, okay, and the velocities of both the balls are non-zero, the angle theta between the final velocities in the left frame is, okay, so we have to calculate the angle theta between the two particles after collision, okay? So this is the case in left frame, and so like this is the particle m1, and the velocity of this particle u1 equals to u, and for the second particle the velocity is 0 because the second particle was initially at rest, okay? So after collision, the two particles is scattered in this way. Theta 1 is the angle of scattering for particle 1, and the velocity after collision for particle 1 will be v1, and theta 2 is the angle of scattering for particle 2, and after collision its velocity will be v2. So we have to calculate the total angle between these two particles after collision. So basically, we have to calculate theta, and theta in this case will be theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay. So now we will use the conservation laws. Okay, so first we will take the horizontal component of momentum in this case. Okay, so before collision, the velocity of the second particle is 0. So the momentum for this particle will also be 0. So in horizontal direction, momentum for particle of mass m1 will be mu, okay? So for all the particles, the mass is same, okay? And the mass is m. So mu equals to mv1 cos theta 1 plus mv2 cos theta 2. Because for this particle after collision, if we take the horizontal component of v1, that will be v1 cos theta 1, okay? So momentum will be mv1 cos theta 1, and similarly for particle 2, the horizontal component of velocity will be v2 cos theta 2. So accordingly, momentum will be mv2 cos theta 2, okay? So mu equals to mv1 cos theta 1 plus mv2 cos theta 2, okay, is the horizontal momentum conservation, okay? And we take m1 equals to m2 equals to m here, okay? So if we take the vertical component of linear momentum So particle 1, the motion is in the horizontal direction only. So there will be no component of momentum in vertical direction, so that the total momentum before collision will be 0. Okay, so after collision, the vertical component of velocity of particle 1 will be v1 sin theta 1. Okay, so momentum in vertical direction will be mv1 sin theta 1, and accordingly for particle 2, the linear momentum in vertical direction will be mv2 sin theta 2. Okay, so this is a conservation for momentum in vertical direction. So now we will also take the energy conservation law, and that will be half mu square equals to half m1 v1 square plus half m2 v2 square. Okay, so m1 m2 are same, and that is m, so we can eliminate the term half m from both sides, and finally u square equals to v1 square plus v2 square. Okay, so we have three equations here, two for momentum conservation and one for energy conservation. Okay, so now we will solve these equation and we will get the value of theta. Okay, so after squaring the equation 1 and 2, we add these two equation and we get u square equals to v1 square cos square theta 1 plus v2 square cos square theta 2 plus v1 square sin square theta 1 plus v2 square sin square theta 2 plus 2v1 v2 cos theta 1 cos theta 2 plus 2v1 v2 sin theta 1 sin theta 2. Okay, so trigonometry is not much difficult. You know many formulas of trigonometry. Cos square theta 1 plus sin square theta 1 will be 1. So put these two terms together, and similarly put the terms, these two terms together. Okay, and take out v1 square and v2 square from these terms, and cos square theta plus sin square theta terms will be 1. So u square equals to v1 square plus v2 square. Okay, so for these two terms, 2v1 v2 and the formula cos theta 1 cos theta 2 plus sin theta 1 sin theta 2 gives you the formula of cos theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay, so you get u square equals to v1 square plus v2 square plus 2v1 v2 cos theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay, so this is the equation number 4. We have also equation 3, in which u square equals to v1 square plus v2 square. Right, so just compare these two equations 3 and 4 and you will get v1 square plus v2 square equals to v1 square plus v2 square plus 2v1 v2 cos theta 1 plus theta 2. Okay, so from this equation it's clear that this term should be equal to 0. Okay, that means cos theta 1 plus theta 2 equals to 0, and 0 is the value of cos pi by 2. So theta 1 plus theta 2 is equals to pi by 2 in this case. Okay, and this theta 1 plus theta 2 is basically theta, so pi by 2 is your answer. That means option A is correct. Okay, hope all these questions and concepts are completely clear to you. If you have any doubt, please ask in comment section. So thanks for watching the video, and if you like the video, please subscribe our channel, and you can ask anything in comment section. Thank you.